Welcome to VidDevoChurch. Now, I don't know if you've ever thought of this, or that you even think this way, or can get as excited as I am right now, today. I was hoping to record this with the snow in the background, because for me, every time I see falling snow, especially the big kind of fluffy flakes. I mean, Alaska, you could get, well, Hyder more than northern Alaska, but Hyder, we used to get these giant fluff balls that were like a hand's breadth. But whenever you see big fluffy snow, I always picture, I guess kind of like that, I always picture grace. I always think of grace. It always reminds me of God's grace towards us. That, you know, while we were yet sinners, Jesus died for us. But more than that, just the very fact that God would choose to love us. I mean, didn't have to. He made us, but, you know, what the heck? He could just as easily delete us. And for some of you, that's easy to unfriend on Facebook or to get rid of on Twitter, to be an unfollower. Now, it's interesting that we have followers on Twitter, we have friends on Facebook. What are we in the sight of God? That's kind of an interesting thing. Here at VidDevoChurch, since we're starting 1.1 today, and it's the inauguration day of the President of the United States, the rise of the false president or the anti-president, the office being occupied by Donald Trump, it's interesting to me to look at chosen as opposed to occupied. You know, a man can occupy an office, and occupying the office of the president doesn't mean he's chosen, it means he's selected. See, the people chose, in a sense, the lesser of two evils. They said, well, you know, we got to pick one. Now, democracy was never supposed to be pick one or the other. It's supposed to have been a variety of peoples and parties making an opportunity to express the fact that someone actually does represent them. Now, I don't have a representative in Congress. I don't have a representative in the House. I don't have a representative in the executive branch or even in the legal branch, because as far as I'm concerned, I'm dead to this world. And because I'm dead to this world, that means I don't have a senator. I don't have a politician doing anything for me. I have a God in heaven who represents me. And Jesus, as my mediator, so to speak, as my high priest, he intercedes on my behalf to God Almighty. I'm not a part of the political system, and I never have been, and I never will be. Because when I got saved, I was dead to the world. Now, I don't know if you understand that, because most Christians I meet, they think that they're somehow mandatory, that it's required, or that it's a part of civil duty somehow to be a part of this world and its ways. Now, if I'm a part of this world and its ways, that means I have to become nationalistic. I have to separate myself from other nations. Jesus said, go into all the nations. Now, if I'm nationalistic, I have to think militaristic, because obviously people say you have to defend your country. So if I'm part of this world, I have to be violent. You see, there's too many things about this world that I'm not, because I'm a Christian. So because I'm chosen, because I've called to be a Christian, chosen to be a son of God, I have to operate on a different scale. I have to become a part of a different system. I can't be a part of the world. I can't follow the gods of men. I have to do what it is that God created me to be. And that isn't a part of this world. Now, I don't know if you realize that, because a lot of people say, well, you know, you got to be the salt, you got to be the light. Yeah, by God causing you to be placed in positions where you know what to do. I can honestly say to most Christians that have done things and act things and be things in politics, God forgive them. They don't know what they're doing, obviously. And you can see that every time there's an election. They'll pick some ungodly man and call him godly. I don't know how they do that, but that's what they're doing in this election, too. But at VidDevoChurch, there's a difference. You see, I didn't choose this. God chose this. I didn't select this. God selected me. I didn't plan on doing this when I wanted to do it. God made it available to me and said, do you want to? Yeah, Lord, please, let me. You know, I volunteered to follow him, and he arranged the circumstances of my life to place me here today in the position as a preacher at VidDevoChurch. VidDevoChurch, as we move into our new camera, as we'll begin adjusting the lights and, you know, doing everything for all the different ministries that we're involved in because of the soon return of Jesus, being that any time between 2017 and 2034, Jesus can return. There could be a rapture, the event, that's what we call it. The second coming, obviously, is going to happen after that. But at any point in time during those years, it's possible for Jesus to return with an 80% possibility. We like to say probability. There's no possible. It's going to happen. When is how soon or how soon or how very soon it will be, because it's going to be soon. You will see it. So at VidDevoChurch, as we will be in the Word of God, by the Spirit of God, to the people of God, of the Son of God, Jesus, we'll be discussing these things, politics and things you shouldn't be involved in, as well as things you should be involved in. You know, like, hey, while I'm recording here, I'm sure that other people are listening. I don't plan on doing it to make other people listen. I don't want or care if other people do listen. It's just God placed me here on my porch in order to be able to enjoy the variety of seasons that He's given me so that it would remind me of the reason I'm here. And that is to be a light, to be salt, to be that testimony or that witness of someone God has chosen. God chooses anyone He uses. God can choose to use Donald Trump for His own reason. It may not be for salvation or as a Christian, but it can be for vessel of dishonor as opposed to vessel of honor. Because even in a house, there's many things that are good and wonderful and marvelous when you go in your house. But it's not too many people that say, hey, come on in here. I want to show you my John. You know, my toilet. I want you to admire the sculpturing of it or how clean it is or how dirty it is. Matter of fact, I don't think too many people are going to, you know, go into your house and go to your bathroom and say, hey, this is really cool. I love your bathroom. It's the most important place in the house. No. So you see, in a house, there's things that are wonderful and that you obviously want to show off, but there are things you don't pay much attention to or you don't want everyone to pay attention to. Just like in God's house, there are things that are of honor and dishonor. So too, we see that in this land. Just because someone is elected doesn't mean God has selected them to be where they are. God allows that to happen by His, fortunately, will to choose to use them as they are in that office. Doesn't mean that they don't have the ability to choose to resign, to go somewhere else, to do what God chooses to use them for. In other words, it's not just simply, oh, well, I can, you know, dictate that since I'm moving into being a president of my club at church or president of my club at school that this is God's will for my life. No, it doesn't work that way. You don't automatically you pick and then dictate that that's what God has selected because you were the one who dictated to Him. That's not how God works. People will tell you all the time that, you know, well, this is the man God put in office. No, this is the man God allowed into office. He's using for His own purpose. Don't make that mistake, because right now there are a lot of Christians that are saying, this is God's man of the hour. He's going to be a Cyrus. He's going to be a great white hope. He's going to be a Jesus. Pardon me, but the man is an atheist, you know. I mean, he really is humanist, and he loves riches, he loves money, and it don't work that way. When I wanted to be in ministry, God said no. Well, He didn't say no. Actually, I think He's probably told me to go into ministry like 30 years or so, maybe 20 years sooner than I actually did. I was in ministry all my life from, oh, I don't know, probably the day I got saved, because the day I got saved, I ran out and told people about my salvation experience. Immediately, I was an evangelist. Some would say an apostle, because an apostle is someone who goes out like a missionary and declares the word of the Lord. I know you're going to define it differently. Fine, go ahead, but, you know, I'm just not going to go there. I'm not an apostle. But as a missionary, you know, I mean, I think that everyone is called to be something. And I don't mean an apostle, an evangelist, or whatever. I mean God has called you for salvation and to testify of what's happened to you. So you are called. You've been called to be that light that God wants to make so bright that the world would come to you and ask, what's different about you? Because right now in the world, I mean, you can look around and see people that are Democrats. And you know what a Democrat's like. At least you think you do. You know what a Republican's, right? At least you think you do, because they don't like each other. They always make up lies about each other. But in humanity, because man looks on the outward things, God looks on the heart, what is and who are, in fact, Christian? You see, a Christian should be someone who isn't involved in the world, but is not of the world, but rather is promoting, excited about, exemplifying, and demonstrating the fact that they don't fear death. They don't care about life. They care about Jesus Christ. They care about what God is doing in your life, the persons around them, and what's God doing in the nation, and acknowledging it's His will to be done, not ours. If God wants to burn, you know, America up, well, He burn it all up. If He wants to save it, He'll save it. But God so far has shed His grace upon it. Doesn't mean we're right. Doesn't mean we're wrong. Just means He shed His grace upon. So, in the same way, when God chooses to use you, don't get all puffed up. Like some ministers and ministries, they get into money. One of the ones that selected Donald Trump is a Christian. You know, is very much into money and wealth and prosperity and all kinds of weird things, you know. And frankly, it's very popular because that's what people want in their flesh. But you see, because I'm a Christian, I already crucified myself to the world way back in 1974 when I got saved. Fortunately, I got the right gospel, because nowadays gospel is about, well, God's got a wonderful plan in your life, and you know, the Christians are all blessed and healthy, wealthy, and wise. There you go. And that's what a lot of people preach. Not me, man. I mean, I'm the actual opposite. I'll say to you, hey, Jesus was not about your wealth or your health or your prosperity. He was about your eternity. He wants you to live an eternity with Him. So, I'm thrilled to be back at doing what VidDevoChurch does. Outside, really, I'm on the porch. Ministering the grace of God that He's given us. Administering that with which God is doing specifically every day, so that I can show you that God is real. That God really does speak audibly. He speaks physically. He speaks emotionally. He speaks spiritually. He speaks in worship. He speaks in work. He speaks everywhere. If you are willing to listen. And that's where we come to the crux of the situation with VidDevoChurch. We don't want anything from you. See, that's the whole difference. God doesn't want anything from you. He wants to give to you so that you get to be with Him. That's the same way we are. We want to give rather than get. We don't get anything out of this. We just do it because it's fun. I love it. I mean, what an honor, what a privilege, what a joy it is for me to go, hey, God, oh boy, what is it today that you want to say? And get on it and get with it and get to it. Meaning that we go ahead and record videos for the benefit of those who are watching and those whom God has chosen to have ears to hear and eyes to see what it is that God is doing with us, to you, and for all of us together. Because we are the body of Christ, but that doesn't mean that everyone that calls themselves a Christian is part of that body. There are cankers, and there are sores, and there are wounds, and there are diseases in the body of Christ. God will remove them, literally. There will be wheat with the tares. In other words, there will be people that are living in the most God-forsaken country in the world, and they will be wheat. There will be a lot of tares in one of the places where God is blessed with grace, like here in America, and it will be a whole bunch of tares. So the difference isn't what we can see and call you're bad, you're good, you're this, you're that. But what God does with you determines who you are. God chooses whom He uses, and He will bless those who rest in Him, not in going out and trying to be pro-abortion or anti-abortion, pro-rights or anti-rights, nationalist, meaning that you're all about the nation of America, or militaristic, you're all about joining the army and fighting and civil whatever, or political, meaning that you get into politics, or even protection, you know, where you get into police forces. Why? Jesus said, they that live by the sword will die by the sword. He didn't tell you to take up a sword, you know, and to carry it from now on. He used that so that people would be ready for the prophecy He's going to fulfill when they took the sword, cut the priest's ear, Jesus heals it and says, Peter, don't do this. Don't you know that they that live by the sword shall die by the sword? Because He already knew that Peter was a violent man. He already knew that he had to make a provable, demonstrable action to his reaction. And that's what's the problem with humanity today. They've forgotten that Jesus is the Prince of Peace. They've decided to redefine Jesus into a way that makes sense to them, as a man, but not as God, not as the Son of God. Prosperity doctrine is famous for that because they make him into being someone who cares about your riches and your glory rather than his glory. And then people say, well, you know, we got to get, you know, for the kingdom's sake, you know, thousands upon thousands of dollars and, you know, use some of it for ourselves, of course, but then, you know, give the rest of it to God so he can use it. You're not God's hands and feet. Miraculously, God is going to preach the gospel to the universe because he's going to send angels into the heavens declaring the gospel to the four corners of the earth. Why does he do that? Because he promised he would. He said he would do it. He didn't say you do it, but he said it would happen. Then we took it as an example for something we should do by using it in order to blackmail, literally, or pressure Christians into gospel, because they weren't. And don't get me wrong, it's a very effective tool, but it was false. And that's what Satan does a lot of times with Christians in general. Gives you an idea you think is right, and rather than ask God what is right, you run with it. Don't do that. VidDevoChurch is all about stop, look, listen. Really, that's our motto now for this new year. Stop what you're doing. Look for the Lord. Listen to what he has to say. Stop, look, listen. You can't get past deception. It's going to deceive you one way or another. Most people I know are deceived in some area of Christianity. Some of them think that babies go to heaven. You know, all babies go to heaven, even though Jesus said there is no other way a man may be saved except through Jesus Christ our Lord. You know, there's no other way that man can be saved except, you know, acknowledging that Jesus is Lord and blah, blah, blah. But people will say, well, they're innocent. Nowhere in the Bible does it say babies are innocent. It says that they are born in sin, conceived in sin, and die in sin. How do you justify that? You don't. You're deceived. That's all. Bottom line. Stop, look, and listen. In other words, James 1:5 says that if any man, woman, or child lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who upbraideth not, but giveth to all men liberally. Nowhere does it say, let someone who lacks wisdom go ask men, or the multitude of counselors, or go look in their Bible, or go figure it out, or go deal with, you know, their own gifts of the Spirit. No. At all. None. Ninguno. James, who wrote it, was the first one to be deceived. He grew up with Jesus and did not recognize him, a type of the nation Israel, his own brother. His own brother didn't recognize that Jesus was the Son of God, the Son of Man. He rejected him. He didn't accept him until after Jesus rose from the dead. And Jesus didn't go specifically to his brother, did he? No. He went to his disciples that God had chosen for him. So you see, it's interesting that you can get deceived even if you are a Christian. In this new age we're living in, this new time frame, the latter days, right before Jesus returns, there are many people deceived by their own wants, their own desires, their own lusts. And I'll give you an example of what I mean by that for those who are supposedly right on. Your children. One of the biggest things that tripped up the Jesus movement was that suddenly, instead of declaring Jesus is coming, Jesus freaks began to have children. And they thought, well, you know, Jesus is coming, but... And they wanted to forestall, and cause somehow Jesus to hold off for a while until their kids grew up. Now you see a little bit of some of the Jesus freaks coming back and going, you know, Jesus is coming, obviously, you know. Some of them have had children die, like in Greg Laurie's case. Some of them have had, you know, other circumstances of major death and circumstances in their own personal life that causes them to rearrange their theology to fit what happened to them. And they realize that death isn't ending, or they have come up with conclusions that are false. Greg is one of them. That, hey, you know what? Babies don't grow up into heaven. I'm sorry. Babies are babies. They die, they die. That's it. They're gone. God doesn't care. God's the one who's in charge. God loves the world, but he created everything. You think that billions of people dying and in hell don't bother him? That's false. But it doesn't mean that he automatically just says, well, fine, you know, you did your best. Come on, let's all go and have a party in heaven. That's not love. That's abhorrent. It's evil. And that's the false theology that a lot of times people get caught up into because they want to believe their baby went to heaven. They want to think that it's better off there with their baby. But you see, even in that, you're putting something between you and Jesus. It doesn't work that way. Our God is a jealous God. He will have no other gods before them, and he will have no other idols. sadly, for some of you, because you really have that mentality that you think you're right, rather than ask and you should receive. Seek and you would find, and knock and the door would be open to you. So, in this era of Christians manipulating the scriptures, manipulating salvation now to include someone who obviously isn't one, manipulating the church, manipulating money and, you know, funds and all kinds of things, now manipulating the government to set up his own little fiefdom, we have, as it were, a time to make your choice. VidDevoChurch has already prophesied and said this. We're in the year of one degree of separation. You are going to start off at the beginning of the year, which we said, and it's going to be just one degree that's going to grow wider and wider and wider and wider from the truth and the lie, from the light and the darkness. It is going to continually separate and go farther and farther apart. If you can't examine your own heart and define for yourself what your faith is, you are already deceived. You've got to get one-on-one. You've got to get alone, not with your pastor. He may help you to do this if you tell him, look, I want to make sure, so I want to sit down and talk to you and, you know, maybe study with you or whatever. And I did that with one church, and it was a wonderful experience, you know. One community church I was in, that's the way the pastor had his church set up, is that you had to sit down and have a Bible study with him. And he went through a kind of like a little Bible study book, but it was like a catechism, you know, in order to be a member of the church, which was kind of cute. He still had some issues, but it was still good. At least you got your doctrine down, pretty much, some of it, most of it. But even saying that, it wasn't right on. There were errors that he had, you know. And the process of doing that meant that I was trusting in the man rather than the message. And the message I knew was wrong. So at some point in time, you have to come to a personal relationship with God that no man can deceive you. No man can mislead you. No one can take you away from what you know today is true with you and God. You need to have that start of a personal relationship, that every day you stop, you look, and you listen. I listen carefully to what people say, and I pick out immediately what's wrong with what they're saying. And then I kind of mention it, and they go, you know, embarrassed. Yeah, you know, I mean, they kind of, you know, in person, they go, well, yeah, you know, there's that, you know. Now, on Facebook, they don't have to admit it, so they sometimes get mad. Sometimes we'll eventually come back and say, you know, you're right. Now, most of them don't. Most of them are just furious. Go well. But I'll just say, look, you know, I'm sorry. You know, this is where you're off. This is what it is. This is the scripture. This is what the history of the church is. This is what it is. You know, these not commentaries, but this is what God says. Why don't you go back? And every time I tell them this, why don't you go back to your studies, where you're studying and how you're studying, and pray about it. Why don't you think about it? Why don't you sit down and have a heart-to-heart? I mean, really, if I was in a relationship with my wife, and I am, and we had a fight, and we do, then I would sit down and talk to her. I wouldn't want to say, hey, you stay mad, you know, and go somewhere. And I'll stay mad, and I'll go somewhere, and we'll be a husband and wife. That's not the way it works. No more than that with your husband and wife is it like with you and God. You can't go along with just your misconceptions, your perceptions, your ideas, your theology, and your religion without getting real with your God. I mean, I don't care who you are. I don't care if you're a Mormon, you're a Catholic, you're a Protestant, you're an atheist, you're a Methodist, you're a humanist, you're a Buddhist, you're a, God knows, Jehovah's Witness or anything. Sooner or later, in your mind, you know inside something's not right or something's wrong. You just don't know what it is sometimes, and so you go along with the plan, or you go along with what you've been taught or told or heard. But what if God is real? What if God really is alive? What if he's living? What if you can ask for wisdom, and he would give it to you? What if that's a fact, Jack? Then you're in the wrong track at the wrong time doing the wrong thing. You need to stop, look for God, listen to what he has to say. So do that. Stop what you're doing. Verify your, you know, nature of your being, meaning that, you know, you're a living being. You have a brain, may be brainwashed, but who knows? May not. You have eyes, maybe you're blind, but, you know, you can have that cleared up, you know, and somehow see. Maybe your ears are plugged up or whatever, and you're listening to the wrong thing, but you can listen or you can conceive. But God created you to be able to find the truth, to find Jesus, to be able to have a relationship, to be able to know the truth and have the truth set you free. So in that, then, you're not going to be able to hold anyone else accountable for you. But rather, you are accountable for you. You are the one that God has chosen to be responsible for you. Now, I'll admit, some of us, you know, in ministry, like pastors, are supposed to be responsible for their flock and all these other things. You know, some of them I question whether they're really a pastor. They're more a preacher like me. But, you know, maybe some of them care and they dare to go there and they visit your home and they stay at your house, you know, and they make sure you're doing all right. And they have walked through the Bible with you step by step, personally, not, you know, some, you know, hey, he's sitting in the back of the church and I know he's there because I see him, but he doesn't really see me. I'm just up here on the front of the stage. You know, maybe there's some pastors like that, and I believe that some ministries do that. But that's what a pastor was supposed to be. Nowadays, they call them pastors. They're really not. They're just preachers. And Calvary Chapel is famous for that. They're not directly involved with you. I'm sorry. You can hear that at a pastor's conference. baby. They may have a little inner circle, but that's about it. You know, because frankly, the rest, oh well, they better pass the test. But that's why Jesus had 12, not thousands. That's why Jesus changed the world with so few and not many. Many are called, but few are chosen. And that's the end of what we're trying to say today. In this inauguration, not only of the presidency, or of our camera, our new camera, or of our new venue, you know, that we're here outside, you know, with Video Church in the morning, but rather, we ought to be about what God wants us to be, as opposed to what we see, what is wrong with the world, rather than what is right with God. We have to change our focus and recognize that we may be the ones with the problem and not the people on the outside. Because I can look around and see, oh, plenty of time and space, you know, to just keep debating, arguing, or pointing the finger at everyone else, rather than look in the mirror and say, hey, I need to stop for a while. I need to look and see where I'm at with my relationship with God, and I need to listen to what God has to say to me today. You see, it really is about stop, look, and listen. It fits. That's why we use some cliches at times in the Word of God about God. And that's why we wanted to start this off today with a cliche. Because Christians today aren't, you know, they got a lot of knowledge, but they got no wisdom at all. At all. I mean, I can have people quote me scriptures that are completely out of context. And that's knowledge. Don't get me wrong. That's wonderful knowledge. I mean, I'm glad they got a topical book that tells them what the topics are for their scriptures, you know, and that they grab at and, you know, post it. But that's not wisdom. Wisdom is the application personally of an experience that you have that makes real the words that are written there in the Bible that become not just the knowledge of God or something that's distant, but rather something that's been experienced personally in a relationship with God that He's made it applicable to you because you've gone through the demonstration of faith to Him and for yourself, that you have wisdom by way of the experience of proving that it's true. In other words, hey, prove something's false, you prove it's true. Really, I mean, I always do that with anything that I hear that's new. You know, if somebody tells me something new, I go out and prove it wrong so that I can prove that it's right. And if I can prove it's wrong, then I know it's wrong. But if I can't prove it's wrong, then I start thinking, well, maybe it's right. And then I start working on proving it's right. You see, I don't work the opposite, or I don't work the same way you do in thinking about things. I want to make sure. I want to make my calling and my election sure. I want to be positive about something I say or teach or preach before I ever bring it before angels in heaven, God Almighty, and you, the people that God has loved so much that He gave His only begotten Son for. Now, I know, you know, a lot of people want to hear me quote scriptures and, you know, put the verse and the chapter to it, you know, and, you know, basically our Bible is, or our motto is Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, and James 1, 5, you know, to trust in the Lord with all our heart, lean not on our own understanding, all our ways acknowledge Him, let Him direct our path, and if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God, and praise God, but give it all our Lord. I mean, after that, it's just what you do, really. So we summed it all up in one verse that says the whole Bible, if you really applied it as God wants to apply it, and that was Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. The entire Bible could be summed up in that one verse, but whether you do it or not, that's a whole different discussion. So, what we want to say to you is that don't get caught up in the world and its ways. But rather, if you want to get caught up, prepare for the soon return of Jesus. Because He's looking for those that are watching for Him. He's asking you to prepare yourself to be ready for heaven. Because if you're not ready, He'll make you ready. He'll send you into great tribulation, clean up your act. You won't be one of those that'll be caught up in the air to meet the Lord there. Maybe at the end of the tribulation or middle or whenever you're going to die as a martyr, but there is a promise to those who are looking for his coming. And I dare to say to you that now, more than any other time, you should be extra stopping, extra looking, extra listening for the fact that God might have as part of his criteria for the event to happen in your life. He might say, hey, remember when I told you to, I'm standing at the door knocking? Remember last night? You missed it. I was knocking at your door. I was going to take you to heaven, but guess what? You were sound asleep. That's a metaphor for you. I hope you're not asleep, but you're awake. That you are not slumbering and sleeping as the world is, but that you are recognizing the signs of the times and the fact that Jesus is coming sooner than you think. So let me just thank you for being who you are, where you are. Because God obviously is going to use you in some way. He's either going to use you like Donald Trump as a demonstration of what not to be, or maybe if Donald Trump gets saved, that's a demonstration of salvation and grace and mercy to someone who obviously doesn't know what he's doing. Or maybe, you know, you are saved and God is going to use you in a peculiar, particular way. Because God has called everyone to salvation, but only few are chosen. So dare I say, make sure you know what your calling is. Make sure that your election is into and of salvation. And make sure you know the Jesus you're following. Because if you don't stop, look, and listen, you're not going to find out that the fact is you may have been following the wrong Jesus all along.